My name is Siddharth, Siddharth Sikdar, and I'm 40 years old. And I grew up in this place called Dehradun, which is near the Himalayas. And so, always had a love for nature. Was always surrounded by beautiful mountains, trees, all that. I have a small family of my wife and a 3.5-year-old kid. We've been staying in Bombay for quite some time now. And I studied mechanical engineering. I graduated in it. And ever since, I've been working in the area of finance, IT, management, and so on and so forth. You see, personally, most of, I think, first realizations come at a personal level. Worldview, ideologies, all these things pretty much, in my case, followed much later. Personally, I was getting stressed at work, which everyone does, but the questions a lot of other people have is, can I get a less stressful job? Can I work and make enough money by 40 so that I can retire by 40? And so on and so forth. I being mostly in management and all this, to do a lot of strategy, which is like future thinking. What's in the future, plans and strategies, tactics, and all this kind of stuff. What that made me was into a future being, completely. And I stopped being very sensitive to the now, the present. And living good quality life now is also very important. So what I thought is, I'll not, slog and make tons of money at the expense of many other things, and then get out of the rat race years later. So it's better to take some steps now. And that's when I decided that, since I haven't got the answers of what is a good life, healthy, better life or whatever, and I would have to discover it, I took a step out of the corporate world. 5 years back, I left a very highly stressful job, and I was on my own. With whatever professional skills I had, I tried to make my living through that. And at the same time, I started exploring many things. I started reading about things first, then started meeting people, then visiting some places where people have been trying various things. One was, any social activity. So I would first go and knock the door of anyone who is doing something, anything social. Who probably had a past like me, who left a corporate job and wanted to do so. So it was a big discovery process. And that discovery process brought me took me to many places, and finally brought me to this realization that, there were many groups, experiments, isms of all kind everywhere, but eventually I would have to make a choice, with whatever inputs I had, whatever is good for me, good for my family, and whatever is good for the future as well as now. I came across a lot of people who had utopian ideas, which were very impractical, and I'm sure many people know of many such ideas. The fact there is that those people completely disregard the present. While we are living, while we are alive, we need to experience joy and happiness even now. So you cannot say that I deny my present and I will only live for the future. So I started then looking at work people are already doing in the present. The eco-village concept came much later on. In fact, healthy living was one of my prime things. Food actually got me triggered. And somewhere I read about, the food we eat, okay, is food nonetheless, but it's not really food, because some of it is food, what you expect it to be. The rest of it is the stuff that goes around food, chemicals, fertilizers, all the manufactured stuff. So one person once gave me a very good example that in future we'll have a tomato which will look like a tomato, red, luscious, juicy. We'll probably have some seeds inside. Will be in the right shape. It will never turn, you know, spindle shape. It will always. So it's you will believe that is food because it has all the characteristics of a tomato, but it has been made into a tomato because it's been ripened. Okay, the juice has come from some other liquid that is inside there, which is being injected, right? The color is because it's been, you know, colored like that, and the shape is because it's been ripened like that. You know, we see this, you know, the kind of food we eat, you know, can create the kind of, the food is pretty much manufactured today. That got me thinking on where does our food come from, the supply chain of food, where it comes from. And, you know, obviously there were a lot of documentaries around, I watched a lot of documentaries, but a lot of them were made with the West in context, not India. But that is good learning. You know, for instance, most of the food doesn't grow in farms any longer, it grows in factories. So what you eat, again coming back to that tomato, you know, it's
manufacturing process.
Yeah, it's got all the properties of a tomato, but years later you'll actually wonder whether that's natural or not, or whether that's food or not. So then I started making local inquiries. Where I was living, I went to the market, I asked the vegetable vendor where he gets, I went to the wholesale market. And I went to some farmers also. I traveled. I actually did that work. And I said, let me not, you know, restrict myself in getting the answers. You know, just because I've never done it before in my life. So let my curiosity drive me. And I got, and I was shocked. It's for people who live in cities, and you know, it might surprise them that most of the food that they eat, a lot of what comes on their plate finally comes through horrible processes of manufacturing things, because city people are really monetizing the people who grow the food in the countryside, farmers who are growing. And what has happened is, so that their products sell in the city market, they should look good, they should have good quality, and they should have this right characteristics of food, as I say, smell, right? You know, and sometimes you see some of it is overdone, like the raisin story we read, right? Raisins are dipped in engine oil and, you know, sun soaked because it can get to the market quicker than a natural way of doing it. Similarly, bananas are ripened. Those bananas sell that look big, large, yellow. You know, very tight, plastic kind of look and feel. Very yellow, you wouldn't want a dull yellow, right? You wouldn't want them black and rotten, okay? And to last longer, because by the time they are plucked from the tree and they end up in a house, you know, they've gone through a huge journey, and they have to really look buyable, pickable, or whatever on the, you know, grocery store or on a vegetable vendor's, you know, shop. And to keep it fresh for that long, you have to do a lot of things with that banana.
Right.
Come to think of it, even the apples we eat, most of the apples that come on our shelves come in, you know, throughout 12 months a year. Apples in Himachal don't grow 12. So they all are coming either from New Zealand or from China or from other countries. And I actually then started studying these things. I said, you actually see, logically, from a time an apple is plucked from a tree till it is put in a crate, till it is packed, till it is from the garden, it is taken to some warehouse. From the warehouse, it goes to a probably air cargo terminal or a ship cargo terminal. From there, it takes off and comes to another airport, or maybe through 2-3 hops comes to some another cargo airport. From there, it is again trucked. It lies in a warehouse. It's trucked. From that trucking point, it gets to APMC market, like Bombay Sanpada APMC market. Or from there, then it goes to the vendor. From the vendor, it sits on the rack, you know. And then you can see that those apples are there for quite a few days, and they still look fresh. Now you calculate the time it is taken from the time it was on the tree to you actually consuming it. How does one keep things so fresh? because you will never buy it if it is not fresh, right? So I did a lot of reading, and a lot of people fortunately had already done a lot of work. So every bit of food that we eat in an urban city like Bombay has some bit of manufacturing done with that natural food. What you're eating looks good in food characteristics, smell, taste, look. It appeals to you, right?
But
yeah, it appeals to your senses, to your smell and all that, and you think that is the right food, but it is not, because it's been tampered with chemicals and all these kind of things. Then there was this another discovery I had, or I stuck upon this other thing, and I inquired about it, was about why in cities people have more cancer, right? Or these kind of new diseases which we call designer diseases and things like that. And you know, funnily, I met a lady who had worked for 25 years with cancer patients at Tata Memorial, and she is a social worker and she worked with them. And she said that, you see, obviously it's a known fact that when you have cancer, you don't know how you got it. Root cause medical science never found, right? But her 25 years of experience taught her enough to come to some conclusion based on patterns. So she's dealt with many different type of patients who come from different parts of India. What are their eating habits, sleeping habits, what are their daily habits and all that. I mean, she put all that together, and that's 25 years of experience. She was beginning to understand pattern. She said urban people who are completely dependent on the modern supply chain of food tend to have more such cases. And what the learning was that food itself is causing some of these problems, because the way our body is made, it is made, our food is there in nature, in the natural form. We are supposed to eat it from there. We do cook, but if we don't take it as close as possible to that natural form, it will create disbalances in our body, because our body genetically built for that, and if it is, and it has to run on that. So why do we eat food? We eat food to grow energy and all that kind. And if the ingredient, if your gadi gets adulterated petrol, it will have a problem. It's the same thing with our body. That's so if the natural food for which is the petrol for our body is adulterated, it will have a problem, right? And so there are two connected. One was I was sure that the food supply chain in cities like Bombay were bad, and the other thing is, and that food that is landing on my plate is causing the health problem. And I thought that if I am not doing this for now, as I coming back to that realization, that why do I have to store a lot of money and then live a life in the countryside when I am giving away the best years of my life to bad food, bad health, and not only me, my family, my kids, why not start now? So I made a lot of decisions. Like I started experimenting with city farming. That's what got me to, can I grow my own food, at least some things. So I had in this very house, I had a terrace farm where I used to get about a kg of veggies, herbs, spices. I even have fruit trees on my terrace, and a banana trees. I had guava, I had pomegranate, papayas, getting about kg a day for my family, okay, which used to consist of everything from potato sometimes to the gourd veggies, like karelas and all that, to tomatoes, to chilies, to pudina, mint and all that. And that was a great thing. It was also a matter of joy, because you are consuming what you are plucking and you are eating, right? Of course, it cannot be scaled for everything, like rice, cereals, and so many other things we need. So that brought me to this question that I put in a lot of effort and I do this on my terrace. It's good enough to take care of part of my food. But I have to consistently put in effort to keep doing this. That brought me to this question of whether this is sustainable at that scale. Now, had we been doing it, let's say, in this society, and you know, all families are doing it together, maybe we would have made. I'd even tried that, but I realized that everyone was not at the same awareness. You know, doesn't have. And by the time I start educating, getting people, many years will be lost. That brought me to the realization that yes, you could live sustainably, you could try these sustainable experiments in a city, but I would rather go and do this in a countryside. So that made me think of eco-village. The problem is that I have always been a city dweller, urban dweller, let's say, town, city, all that. I wasn't very sure that I was ready to shift to a village just because I wanted to realize my dream of good food, healthy, and just that, because I wasn't aware of many other things till then. Okay, so I stretched my again curiosity further, let it go, and I said, so why not go and stay somewhere and you know do this? It's a big leap for me because I was still making my living out of an urban setting, and you know whether that is possible. And so that led me to thinking of, you know, like countryside living, taking a farm and doing something there. And that's where my initial ideas came. And when I started meeting some people who had done that, I was really in awe of many people. But very soon that awe converted into a kind of, you know, this big question that why are they doing it alone? And, you know, and why? And I realized that there were limits to what you could do if you a single family goes to a countryside and tries and do all these things, to put all these things, sustainable living together, you know, growing organic veggies. And then I had met a lot of city people who would travel every weekend to farms and, you know, do some work on the farm, get some produce and bring it to the cities, or they'll have some labor on the farm that will do that. So that's also, you know, was called sustainable. So I was pretty, you know, not very convinced, you know. And I think eventually that brought me to the eco-village because it also brought the community aspect to it, which is you cannot do it alone. You have to do with people and humans, and our social linking and bonding is as important as our quest for you know, natural living or organic food and so on and so forth. So as you see, I've been putting together many pieces into this, you know, framework that I'm trying to build in my mind of holistic living. After that, I connected with people, I connected with you and many others.
Right.
And the ball is rolling since then. I mean, we've been looking for land, we've formed a group, now the structure and all that. I kind of take a little bit more time in telling this story of this journey.
Yeah.
This journey is on. I mean, we were far from. I think there is that, you know, I didn't get fixed with any assumptions, okay, and I didn't want to do that. That, you know, be part of something and everything will be taken care of. You know, like being part of a group and everything else will be taken care of. We're still questioning, as you know, eco-village, every bit of it, right?
Yeah.
And that's a way, because there is no replicable model that we today have in the world of living sustainably. I think everyone is in some stage of experiment. Even people who live in eco-villages in the West, which I'm old aware of, even in Pondicherry, even in many places. When we, you know, like for instance, Sadhana Forest, as you said, but they take donations, whether donation is sustainable, then others. So I think even practitioners of eco-villages and sustainable living, they admit that it's an experiment, it's a journey to go on. And because this is not mainstream yet in the world, right? Somewhere it will be like this, different experiences. Never completely fulfilling, but definitely will, you know, will keep evolving all the time. So it's not stagnating. And I think in today's context, in 2012, I came to know about the Zeitgeist movement through you, about resource-based economy. I had also studied peak oil. You know, I spent months studying peak oil. So that was another context. And why I think we must act now in whatever ways are possible to us. I'm not saying take large big bang steps now, but even small steps are good, is because the prosperity that you see around you is somewhere, it all links to energy or fossil fuel energy, right? If we didn't have this, it would take, you know, let's say 5 hours to walk from my house to my office, let's say, which I do very simply in a few minutes. We assume so much of it, of these conveniences, comforts, and the so-called things of prosperity, because it's all fueled by fossil fuel. Imagine a life where it is not there. We still don't have an alternate to fossil fuel, right? And the revelation that peak oil has, which is that all fossil fuels are limited resources, they are going to run out, and they don't, and we can actually predict by when serious effects will, you know, will come into place, like the supply will go down. You know, a country like India, which grows at 8%, and which is basically GDP, which is India's growth, is actually a measure. Any country's GDP and growth is a measure of not just its economy, but its energy and its energy stock, insurance, you know, so to say. And if you are not good on that, and if you don't have that supply in the next 10 years, 15 years, you will never be able to maintain this kind of growth rate. So basically, peak oil, energy, future living, I think these have serious implications right down to an ordinary individual like any of us. We only see its, if we are not aware, we will only see its after effects as price rise. Petrol went up, this went up, that went up. We'll cribble a little more, but we'll still go along, play along, because it will not fundamentally alter our lifestyle probably so soon. But eventually one day it will. And this is a realization that the end result of peak oil and this energy, you know, limited fossil fuel, we only realize it as a price. Right, but the more you study about it, how much of oil we have, and it's going to run out, and we have already actually, by the best of estimates, we have gone, the world has gone past the peak of oil, okay, and which basically means we have just about less than half of the oil reserve that were already there when we first started drilling for oil, okay. So that's not very good news, because we don't have something as concentrated energy form as oil today. Solar panels, wind, nothing comes as close. There are untested technology, they'll take years to come up, like hydrogen fuel and all those kind of things. The fact of the matter is, the infrastructure that we have, we built prosperity around us, but we have to maintain this prosperity. The roads that we built, someone has to maintain the highways, someone has to maintain the roads, someone has to maintain the buildings. You know, to clean the building, you need some machinery. The machinery is run by electricity. That is run by coal. It is run by coal dug from the earth. That is running out. So even maintaining this prosperity is difficult. That is why there was a guy who famously said that the future could be one of prosperity, but without growth. So the saying is prosperity without growth. You could have a growth-free society. Don't aspire for, you know, this kind of growth that we are seeing. Yet you will be prosperous, yet you will be happy. And that's what an eco-village is. It is creating abundance, food abundance, energy abundance, water abundance. But it is doing it sustainably, because it will last. There is no growth in that. I am not producing to, veggies for a mass market, for, you know, we are doing first for how much the earth can give, how much the earth can produce, and how much we need to consume. So, and if we are taken care of, we are prosperous. That's the planning for an eco-village. That's the philosophy that runs behind the eco-village. So, eventually realizing how to live sustainably in a community, local living, which means survive mostly on local resources and leave energy conscious living, which is we are aware of how we are interacting with available energy, how much of it you are using, consuming, and the way we can make better efficient passive designs in our eco village. And you know, it's about going and living there. So it's not creating a model there that you keep visiting and showcasing to the world. It is not for individual greatness, that you know, getting a Nobel Prize in peace or something like that. Okay. It's about what everyone's future will be tomorrow. So we are just handful who started pretty much early, who are more you know, impatient to get going, so to say. And so I think all eco villages are spurred by that thinking. Some of them have a spiritual connection, I mean bonding. A reason for getting together was spiritual, but I think they also realize that discovering a sustainable way of living is very important. Couple of things I want to share in this context is what we are doing. Again, there are people with various views, but I think the common minimum is definitely that we want to have a local living, you know, which is more dependent on resources drawn from the local environment. So it's, you know, things in the eco village don't travel large distances into the eco village and all that. Also, we think that in the years to come, 10, 15 years or something, if I look, my sense is that a lot of people will be asking, where are eco villages? Can I go and live in that now? You know, like today, 50 years later, most, let's say, middle class educated people used to build their own homes. They will take the whole task of building their own home. Today we have ready-made homes, you know, like societies and all, and people, okay, you know, there's this whole marketing advertising around you all the time. You know, you drive into Pune, you see hoardings everywhere, and so you just buy into one, right? A day will come when people will say, where are the eco villages? And I don't want that eco villages should go on billboards as advertisement, but there will seriously people will be asking. And I know for sure in America, a lot of people are actually doing it. Especially after the 2008, you know, crash, where they've realized that lifestyles are unsustainable unless you really are on Wall Street and make tons of money. Even decent money is becoming very difficult, you know, comfortably and all that, because they already have a history of a lot of infrastructure built, the comfort they've built, and to maintain it needs huge doses of energy, which means huge doses of money. And none of US energy is actually all produced in US, it is all bought, you know, and all that. So people have, those who made that connection, understood that, have started asking, where are the eco villages in US? Can I go and stay there? So they are looking at joining some eco villages. So I think in India we might be just catching up on that, but all eco villages are good to me. I think they might have a lot of differences in opinion. I know there are a lot of eco villages that just differ because the ideologies are different. Some are vegetarian eco villages, some are non-vegetarian eco villages, that kind of stuff. But according to me, all are great starts. We need more of these. And because if there are more trials, the, you know, the better results will come out. We'll know better what works, what doesn't work. So I think the 1,000 flowers, if they bloom, you know, I'm very happy with that. There should be more eco villages. We are doing a bit in with Salens, so we want to do, you know, we have a group. Not to discount the fact that there can't be other eco, there will be, and they will do that. We don't have anything unique as such. I think more or less the same things everyone else is pursuing. our preference is to do an eco village in the countryside. We had a land selection criteria where we want to do it, and one of the thoughts that we had also put into selecting was climate change and future weather patterns. And we thought it would be better to place ourselves in a place which already has rain abundance. Okay, so that even if due to climate change rain patterns fall or changes, we still are in a place where there's water abundance. Because as someone told me, the three most important thing when you design for land in eco village is water, water, and water. You know, so that probably is the only other thing we have thought. Other than that, we think like most eco villages. In fact, I don't know whether we should actually ask that question, because all the time we are reading about other eco villages and their experience and assimilating it. So I think that is how the eco village environment or ecology is, that it's intermingling of ideas and trying it out locally. So you could start an eco village anywhere. If you have got friends who think alike, start there, and there will always be idea sharing all the time, which is happening. It is a lovely thing, because no one stops back at sharing anything in the global eco village network. You know, they just share.
Great, thank you.
That's it.
Ha ha ha.